Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Playing Through the Pain, Ken Caminiti and the Steroids Confession That Changed Baseball Forever by Dan Good. Narrated by Tom Parks. Introduction. Ken Caminiti's world was falling apart, again, but he was in New York City trying to make things right. The veteran third baseman spent his career waiting for this moment. He'd endured so many lost years on bad teams in worse uniforms, he was finally playing for a winner. The 1998 National League champion San Diego Padres, going into the World Series, four wins away from baseball glory. But there was a problem. Those four wins would have to come against baseball's most successful franchise, the New York Yankees, in its most successful year. The Yankees steamrolled the American League in 1998, winning 121 games during the regular season and playoffs. No team had ever won that many games in a season. But minutes before the start of Game 1, Ken's mind wasn't on the Yankees, or the lost seasons, or that night's pitcher, or his hitting approach. He was dealing with other problems. Ken was back to using drugs and surrounding himself with the wrong people, leaving his marriage frayed and fueling an endless cycle of disappointment and frustration and shame. Ken shouldn't have been playing. His legs were failing him, but that never stopped him before. And this was the World Series, damn it. Bruce Bochy, the legendary skipper managing in his first World Series, who adored Ken like a son, wrote his name on the lineup card as usual. What other options did he have? A hobbled Ken Caminiti meant more to the Padres at third base in reputation alone than a healthy George Arias or Andy Sheets. No offense meant to either, but they weren't badass former MVPs whose scowls intimidated fellow players. There was always the hope that Ken would rise to the occasion, just like he had in Monterrey, Mexico 2 years earlier, when he got food poisoning and took IV fluid and ate a Snickers bar, and, barely able to stand upright, still smacked two home runs. He wobbled as he rounded the bases that day, his accomplishments burnished into legend. Or weeks before the World Series, in the playoffs against the Atlanta Braves, when he slugged a 10th-inning home run to put the Padres one step closer to the Fall Classic. History was not on San Diego's side. The Padres had reached the World Series once before, but lost. The Yankees, meanwhile, had won 23 World Championships on the strength of players like Ruth and Gehrig and DiMaggio and Mantle and Berra. One more title would tie the Yankees for the most championships in North American professional sports. On paper, Yankees versus Padres in 1998 made David versus Goliath look like an even matchup. As if the challenge wasn't difficult enough for San Diego, the World Series was opening in Yankee Stadium, a concrete and steel cathedral that had experienced more winning than a two-headed coin. The night of Game 1, October 17, 1998, was crisp and clear, 56 degrees. Fans brought long-sleeve shirts and 60-grit sandpaper personalities. The 4D subway lines shuttled the sardines decked in navy and white to 161st Street. The unfortunate souls who chose to wear San Diego gear could expect to face death threats and fuck the Padres' chance. It wasn't personal. It was the Yankees. Red, white, and blue bunting covered the stadium's edges, a patriotic touch for the extra special occasions such as the 1998 World Series, the capstone to one of Major League Baseball's magical seasons, when a home run chase between sluggers Mark McGwire and Sammy Sosa enthralled the nation. The two men went on a summer-long testosterone tour, smacking dingers at a prodigious rate. Few questioned the home run display, and those who did were brushed aside. We were blinded by power. We were back in love with baseball. The drive from Yankee Stadium to the Bronx's Hunts Point section takes less than 15 minutes if traffic is thin. The direct route takes you east on 161st Street, underneath the elevated subway platforms, swerving around pesky double parkers. The route twists and turns, and you follow it. Along the way, the rust and graffiti and decay became more prevalent. Duck under a highway overpass, and then you reach the 1200 block of Seneca Avenue. If heroes are made at Yankee Stadium, people are overlooked on Seneca Avenue. A man sits on a stoop, scanning the passing cars. Children play in the shadows of surveillance cameras, throwing matchbox cars at birds. An apartment building is wedged in the middle of the block, identified by a stucco sign on the front, the Ruth Apartment. On a different October day, not far removed from his World Series appearance playing in The House That Ruth Built, Ken Caminiti spent his final moments here. He could have been anywhere else. Chapter 1. Batman. Kenny was always trying to fly. That's what he was doing on the stairs at 2.5 years old. He thought he was Batman, the caped crime-fighting crusader played on TV by Adam West. Instead of flying, Kenny tumbled down the stairs, 30 pounds of energy and dreams and rug burns. Come to think of it, Batman never actually could fly. Given Kenny's aerial and athletic pursuits, Cordoy Lane was just about the perfect place for him to grow up. The street, part of the Cambrian Park neighborhood in southern San Jose, California, was developed in phases, starting with Kenny's section in the 1960s, then growing to include a perpendicular addition so it resembled a curved L shape. The curve at the intersection of those two ends made an ideal spot for pickup games. The neighborhood was surrounded by plum orchards and open fields and rock quarries, and given the proximity of schools, more than a dozen within 2 miles, you could usually find a baseball, football, or basketball game in progress by hopping on your bike and riding around for a few minutes. With so many young families, kids' voices served as a neighborhood soundtrack. The neighborhood and houses and street and schools and sports fields were all new, a reflection of San Jose's growth. It was a nice middle-class upbringing, in contrast to the city's overlooked minority and lower-income neighborhoods and the ritzy town of Los Gatos a few blocks south. Kenny's family lived at 5129 Cordoy Lane, a split-level home with a garage and 4 bedrooms. The house had a swimming pool in the backyard. Families living nearby would become the Caminiti's friends, the Rosses, the Whedons, the Constantinis, and Noriegas. Steve Reinhardt lived across the street from the Caminiti's and was Kenny's age. It was a dead-end street for a lot of years. So out in front of the houses, out in the orchard next to us or the field a few blocks away or the quarry, there was plenty of open dirt to go play in, Reinhardt said. Peggy Whedon recalled Kenny being a sweet, innocent, inquisitive boy. When he was 5 or 6 years old, before the neighborhood was fully developed, the Whedons had the last house, and beyond their house was a large field that filled up with water whenever it rained. There were frogs there. Kenny was fascinated with the frogs and kept pointing out, "Look, there's a double-decker," and another, not realizing they were mating, Peggy Whedon said. Chris Camilli's family lived one street over on Elrose Avenue. If I went outside my front door and I threw a tennis ball over 2 houses and bounced it on the street, I could probably one-hop it to his house, Camilli said. Chris and Ken normally got grouped together because of their names, strong, powerful Italian surnames starting with Cammy. The curly-haired, soft-spoken Chris came from a sports family. His grandfather, Dolph, played 12 seasons of Major League Baseball during the 1930s and 40s, hitting 239 career home runs and winning a Most Valuable Player award, while his uncle Doug caught one of Sandy Koufax's no-hitters for the Los Angeles Dodgers. Chris and Ken would spend hours playing traditional sports and inventing their own games, like seeing who could hit a rock with a bat the farthest. Ping, ping, they'd play until someone hit a house. Ping, or they got into trouble, and that would be the end of it, until they came up with something else to do. Kenny wasn't one to stay indoors. He was a restless kid, Camille said. He didn't like to play board games and watch TV. Kenny and the other kids were expected to be outside all day, and parents generally weren't keeping track of what their children were doing. You'd ride your bikes to the rock quarry and bike on a trail or do some jumps, and when it got too hot, you'd go to someone's house and hose yourself down, then sit in the shade and cool off, then maybe go to 7-Eleven and get a Slurpee, then go out and ride your bike some more, and you came home for dinner and stayed out until dark, and everything seemed so innocent, even if it wasn't. Glenn Caminiti was tough, the kind of kid who would truck you in a flag football game just because. But he was also nurturing and protective of his brother, who was 2 years younger, a trait he shared with his sister, Carrie, who was 4 years older than Kenny. Glenn could have dumped Kenny and left him behind, embarrassed and ashamed to hang out with his kid brother. Instead, he included Kenny in games with the older kids. Kenny consistently tagged along and played sports against Glenn's friends, the smallest kid on the field. Kenny was talented, but he was also pint-sized. No matter how hard Kenny hit, no matter how hard he tried to prove himself, he was known as Glenn's little brother. Glenn was the three-sport star who towered over everyone, a physical beast and a badass in football, basketball, and baseball. Glenn's little brother happened to play the same sports. Given the Caminiti's competitive household, even something as casual as ping pong could turn into all-out warfare, Kenny inevitably found himself locked in a sibling rivalry, losing the arms and legs race against his older, bigger brother. Glenn and Ken couldn't help but get grouped together. Two brothers, 2 years apart, with the same interests and passions, jockeying for attention and approval and respect. Their names even rhymed, Glenn and Ken. It was his oldest, truest rivalry, one born from love and lineage. Glenn was always riding him, and that's what kind of made Ken the person he is, Kenny's childhood friend Peter Marin said. He always tried to be as good as his brother. But Kenny wasn't Glenn. Kenny was more sensitive than his older brother, a reflection of his closeness to his mother Yvonne. His father Lee, meanwhile, encouraged his athletic pursuits. He was his mom's boy, Peggy Whedon said, adding, he worshipped his dad, and he always tried to work hard to make his dad proud. Nick Dirksen and Kenny used to ride their bikes to Little League practice together. Two boys with their baseball mitts over their handlebars and wads of bazooka in their cheeks. They played together in 1973 and 1974 in Union Little League. For Dirksen, one quality made Kenny stand out above everyone else, his cannon arm. Kenny could rifle throws from the hole in shortstop. With Kenny's arm strength, no runner was safe on a ground ball. He'd rear back and fire, and the ball became a blur of white heat. An arm like Kenny's could dominate Little League, with him pitching every few games and shifting between the mound and shortstop. After all, his daddy was a pretty good pitcher. But that was the problem. Lee Caminiti, a former prep pitching and catching star himself, didn't want his son pitching or catching in Little League. Kenny's arm and body were too valuable. Too much wear and tear, and Kenny's gift would be gone. Another boy who could have been something. So, Lee Caminiti forbade Kenny's Little League managers from allowing his son to pitch or catch. Kenny was an infielder. As a result, the best arm in Union Little League was largely hidden away. There would be time for Kenny to show off his arm strength. Dave Moretti was 6 years old when he first met Kenny. Their brothers played on the same Little League team, and 8-year-old Kenny was the bat boy, and Dave wanted to be a bat boy too. So, for the next game, Dave dressed the part. He wore his San Francisco Giants pajamas. The PJs looked enough like an actual baseball uniform to suffice, so Dave and Kenny started serving together as bat boys. Ken wasn't real thrilled, Moretti said. He didn't want to share duties. Kenny's mother, Yvonne, encouraged him to be nice, and halfway through the game he came up to Dave and they started talking, and that's how their friendship began. In a way, Dave represented the younger brother Kenny never had. They were both loyal and competitive and fiery, and they loved each other. And they butted heads, and then they wouldn't talk for a while, and then they'd reconnect and pick up like nothing had happened. Moretti remembers going over to the Caminiti's house with his older brother Mark when he was in 4th or 5th grade. Someone showed up with a 6-pack. The older guys were having a beer, and Glenn was bribing Ken not to tell his mom with popsicles, Moretti said. Glenn didn't want to explain to his parents why the popsicles were gone, but the alternative would be worse. Little Moretti's not going to say anything to his parents, and I got to bribe you with popsicles, Glenn told his brother. Kenny got his popsicles, and little Moretti and Kenny both kept their secrets. They were good at keeping secrets. Lone Hill Elementary School was north of Kenny's neighborhood, and the middle school was to the west, and the high school was south. The setup allowed the same children to go to school together from kindergarten to high school, a tight-knit bond that they'd carry throughout their lives. These are the people you grew up with. San Jose lifers identify themselves by their elementary school, and these were Lone Hill kids. The school was located next to a creek, and there was a culvert underneath a chain-link fence. Kenny showed off his mischievous side at Lone Hill, pulling pranks he learned from older kids, and he'd giggle and give you that playful glance, letting you in on the joke with a glimmer of childishness in his eyes. Kenny always had two sides to him, Camille said. He had a side that he would be the kid that every parent would just love, and then he had that mischievous side where, when he was away from adults or around people he was comfortable with, he liked to push things a little bit. He'd like to make people laugh. For Kenny and Chris Camille and a group of their classmates, recess was all about sports. They would draft teams and play 5-game series of football or basketball over the course of a week. Then the next week, they would draft new teams and play a new series. Stats were kept from the games. This was serious business. By 5th grade, when the boys began playing basketball, some guys didn't want to play on the same team as Kenny because he always shot, Camille remembers. A couple of them decided to keep track of Kenny's stats and calculate his shooting percentage. I think they did it over 2 days, and then they shared that with everyone. And I remember Kenny was really hurt by that, Camille said. People were laughing and stuff like that, and he just took it really, really bad. Kids can be mean. But Sharon Russell never saw that from Kenny. Russell lived at the corner of Elrose Avenue and Michonne Drive in the summer of 1974, so Kenny, then 11 years old, walked past her house with his bat and glove whenever he went to the park or elementary school. He was like the Pied Piper, because he had all the neighborhood kids with him, and they would follow him, she said. And if they were going to the park, 15 or 20 kids would be following Kenny to the park. Sharon would be outside with her son, Greg, then a toddler, when Kenny returned from the park, and she would give Kenny cookies and lemonade. Mrs. Russell, I'm going to teach Greg how to play baseball, Kenny promised. As soon as he's walking, Kenny, Sharon said, he isn't walking yet. Soon enough, Greg started walking, so Kenny would go over to the Russells and gently throw the ball underhand to Greg, and Greg would pick up the ball and throw it back. He was so sweet, Sharon said. There were some bratty kids in the neighborhood, but he was never one of them. The glass bottle spun on the cold concrete, warping and twisting the view of the pretty faces as it landed on its target. Kim Eichholz Novielli was in the Caminiti's garage, along with Glenn and Ken and another neighborhood girl, playing spin the bottle. Whoever spins the bottle has to kiss the person sitting where the bottleneck points. Kim's family lived in the house that shared a backyard fence with the Caminiti's. She was 3 years older than Ken. Her brother and Glenn were good friends. Ken was so young. I was in high school, and I was the first girl he ever kissed, she said. Kim remembers Kenny being very shy, with a smile perpetually on his face when he was young. Many of Kenny's female classmates wish they could have traded places with Kim. The girls all loved Kenny. He was shy and unassuming, and so damn cute, with his effortless laugh and those eyes that would burrow into your soul. He was such a beautiful person, said Claudia Henderson Druin, a classmate from kindergarten through high school. Debbie Eason, who started attending Lone Hill School as a quiet 10-year-old, thought Kenny was crush-worthy. So much so, she was happy to learn that her dog Peaky had run away to Kenny's house, so she'd have a reason to visit. Chris Camille's mother, Karen, loved cooking big breakfasts full of pancakes or waffles or French toast, bacon and eggs, heapings of food. By the time sixth grade rolled around, and for years after that, Kenny would come over every morning to eat breakfast with his friend's family. It got to the point where he didn't even knock on the door. He would just come in and eat breakfast, Chris Camille said. He kind of became part of the family. After 3 or 4 years of breakfasts with the Camilles, Chris was talking to Kenny's parents and realized that they weren't aware that Kenny had been eating with his friend's family. He was eating two breakfasts, Chris said. I think he was eating cereal at his house, and then he'd come over to our house and have breakfast, and then we'd go to school. That went on for years and years, and his parents had no idea. That's how things were back then in the neighborhood. Secrets, little ones and big ones, remained buried away, and parents remained largely in the dark on what their children were doing. We knew nothing. I thought we were very observant and talked about things with each other and the kids, and we didn't know a thing about what was going on, said Margaret Sparks, a friend of Yvonne's, whose son became friendly with Ken and Glenn. Some of the secrets were innocuous. Peggy Whedon's house had a large plate glass window in the front. One day, the window was broken by a baseball. Her two boys, Daryl and Brian, tried to explain what happened. Daryl can't throw, Brian said. Brian can't catch, Daryl said. It was only years later that Peggy learned the truth, that Kenny's errant throw had broken the window. There's a lot of stuff I learned way long after the fact about keeping secrets, and there'd be things that would happen in the neighborhood, Peggy Whedon said. There was that secrecy thing. That secrecy extended to the use of drugs and alcohol, which were everywhere in San Jose during the 1970s, readily available for kids who had lots of freedom and little supervision. Older siblings passed things down to their younger brothers and sisters. Kenny began drinking beer by middle school. It was easy to obtain. If Kenny and his friends wanted alcohol, they could ride their bikes to 7-Eleven and wait for the right person to shoulder tap, standing outside the store and asking an older customer to pick something up for them. No one thought much of it. Beer made Kenny feel less self-conscious. Beer helped him turn his mind off and stop judging himself. Beer helped him escape. Alcohol to me, I guess growing up, it was something that changed my mood, Ken told ESPN's Tom Friend in 1998. I mean, I got invincible. I had this suit of armor on. Chapter 2. The Valley of Heart's Delight. Leroy Caminiti could have played pro baseball. Caminiti was a standout pitcher and catcher, and also played football and basketball at Murray F. Tooley High School on Chicago's West Side in the years following World War II. Leroy, also known as Lee, showed lots of talent while playing for Thule. On May 1, 1950, he pitched a no-hitter against Kelvin Park, despite walking three batters and giving up two runs. Lee had those intangible qualities scouts are always looking for. He was analytical and bright, smart enough to finish a New York Times crossword, and with the body of a dancer, a thin waist, firm shoulders, and a muscular build. He was good at figuring things out and getting things done. Leroy's parents were both second-generation Americans. His paternal grandparents were born in Italy, while the relatives of his mother, Mary, hailed from Lithuania. Leroy, born in 1932, and his brother, Donald, a year and a half older, grew up in the height of the Great Depression. Their father, Samuel, worked as an auto mechanic. Some of Lee's high school teammates entered the pro baseball ranks after graduation, playing for minor league teams like the Janesville Cubs and Keokuk Colonels. But Lee was meant for a life beyond baseball, and that's what he found after graduating from Thule in June 1950. Yvonne Bai was a go-getter. The blonde-haired stunner of Norwegian and French heritage participated in numerous clubs and committees during her time at Thule High, from secretary of the Marionette Club to a hall guard captain and member of the class night dance committee. Her busy high school career exemplified the school's academic focus. Alums included Saul Bellow, the Pulitzer and Nobel-winning writer. Famed football coach Newt Rockne attended Thule but didn't graduate. Thule was never a jock school. It produced lovers and authors, said Dan Maxime, who attended the school at the same time as Lee and Yvonne and later became a Thule historian. Yvonne, born in 1931 in Cicero, a suburb of Chicago, was Lauren and Thelma Bai's second child, coming 3 years behind her brother, Eugene. Her father spent decades working at Belden Electrical Company in Chicago. Yvonne and Leroy were high school sweethearts. They made a stunning couple. His olive skin and his hair as sharp as a well-manicured golf green, her pale skin and clear complexion and warm smile. She was drawn to his eyes, those lovely eyes. The war between North and South Korea began the month Lee graduated from Thule High, and Lee was one of the 1.7 million brave Americans who participated in the conflict. The war, which took millions of lives between 1950 and 1953, pitted the communist-backed North against the United Nations-supported South. Both sides staked a claim as Korea's one true government. North Korea invaded South Korea on June 25, 1950. Within days, President Harry S. Truman ordered U.S. troops to the Korean Peninsula. Years of bloodshed ensued. Although an armistice was signed in 1953, a settlement of the war was never reached. Lee was still stationed in Korea in 1954. His former Thule classmate Dan Maxine bumped into him at a Seoul air base, a chance meeting 6,500 miles away from home. The classmates snapped a photo together. Lee's belt is cinched tight around his narrow waist. His badge-covered shoulder sleeves hint at the muscle underneath. The badges identify his rank and company as a sergeant with the 7th Infantry Division, a unit that was involved in some of the war's key battles, including the battles of Porkchop Hill and Old Baldy. Lee never talked much about his wartime service. He didn't talk about a lot of things. After Lee returned to the States, he settled some unfinished business. He and Yvonne married on April 28, 1956, in Illinois. He also had a fling with that other love he left behind, playing some semi-pro baseball. The young couple bounced around the country. They moved to Florida in 1957, and Lee got a job at the Martin Company, which made bombers and rockets. The Caminitis moved to California by the end of the decade. Their family expanded. A daughter, Carrie Lee, was born in 1959. A son, Glenn Scott, followed 2 years later. They were living in Lemoore, near Hanford in South Central California, when their third child, another son, was born. Kenneth Gene Caminiti came into the world on April 21, 1963, at Hanford's Sacred Heart Hospital. When their baby boy was a few months old, the family moved north to San Jose so Lee could take a job at Lockheed, the aerospace and defense company. San Jose wasn't known as a tech hub or the sprawling nexus of Silicon Valley when the Caminitis moved there. Instead, it was famous for its orchards, the Valley of Heart's Delight. The city, located in Northern California's Santa Clara Valley, south of San Francisco Bay, housed miles of plum and apple and cherry trees, making the air sweet enough to taste. San Jose's temperate climate and arid soil made it a prime growing location. The city is buttressed by mountains, and the Santa Cruz Mountains separate it from the Pacific Ocean. The Caminitis moved along Southwood Drive in West San Jose in 1963. The Caminitis, young and friendly and fun, quickly bonded with their neighbors. "Mr. Caminiti was like my idol," said Rob Hart, whose family lived next door to the Caminitis during the mid-1960s. "He was the ideal dad. He played wiffle ball with us." After a few years on Southwood Drive, the Caminitis settled into the house on Cordoy Lane, the street that eventually shaped into a curved L. And that's where Lee and Yvonne would stay for 4 decades, through the successes and struggles and jubilation and tears. As the years passed, Lee's duties at Lockheed remained a guarded secret. Ken's friends would needle him about his father's mysterious profession, jokingly calling him I Spy, referencing the 1960s TV series. Even Ken didn't know what his father did for a living, only that it was at Lockheed. His friends didn't need to waste their time. "He won't tell you. Don't ask about it," Ken would say. No one generally bothered asking Lee because they were too afraid. Lee wouldn't tell them anyway about his work tracking Russian subs using water displacement. At least that's the rumor, or whatever else he was doing for Uncle Sam. Eventually, Yvonne started working there too as an executive secretary. They remained a stunning couple. She continued to be drawn to his eyes, those lovely eyes. Chapter 3. Not So Big Man on Campus. Kenny tried to hold back the tears. He didn't want to let anyone know his pain, especially not his freshman football coach, Hal Kolstad. Kenny's arm was a 4-alarm fire whenever he moved it. So he held the arm firm as he ran off the field, pleading with Kolstad to let him stay in the game. "He never cried in public about anything, but he cried when he couldn't go back in," said Kolstad, who also coached Ken in baseball at San Jose's Lee High School. The next day, Kenny showed up at school in a cast. Despite the bumps and bruises and the occasional broken bone, Kenny gravitated to football, where he could hit as hard as he wanted, a locomotive with a departure time every 30 seconds or so, the little engine that could. "At a buck 25, Ken could put a wallop on you like no one's business," said Mark Boozing, a classmate who played high school football with Kenny. "He would just dive into you, you know, helmets and shoulder pads, that he's ringing your bell, even at a buck 25. Playing with Glenn and other local kids helped make Kenny fearless. He was always matching up against bigger kids and holding his own. "Saturday mornings, I'd go to the high school after I graduated and just play pickup games, and Kenny was always there. And he was a small kid back then," remembers Michael Volska, who graduated in 1977. Glenn was big man on campus at Lee High School, a renegade football player, the tallest player on the team, with perfectly feathered hair to match. He also played baseball and basketball. Kenny just scratching 5 feet tall, was a pint-sized boy stuck in his brother's shadow. Glenn was a grown man. Ken was just a kid. Glenn was protective of him, that's for sure, said Hardy Watkins, who played football and baseball at Lee with both of the brothers. The brothers' contrasts went beyond their size and maturity. Glenn was cocksure and extroverted. Kenny was sensitive and quiet. Glenn was more of a troublemaker. Kenny was kind. There was a sibling rivalry brewing between Glenn and Kenny. It's bound to happen with two brothers so close together pursuing the same interests, baby birds seeking the same worm. But underneath the rivalry was love, an older boy who would do anything for his younger brother. With an older brother leading the way and involved, caring parents, Kenny had a strong support network. Someone else would enter his life, too. Someone who would bring love and stability and would stand by Kenny through so many of his ups and downs. Kenny's early relationships would emerge and recede gradually, waves brushing the sand, background noise to his truest, oldest love of sports. Tammy Ivankovich Cabri was his girlfriend in ninth grade, and they spent about half the school year dating. I always kind of had a crush on him in middle school. It wasn't until our freshman year that things kind of sparked, and then we started dating, Tammy said. He was a great athlete, a great person. He was attractive. There was a lot that drew me toward liking him. He was always a nice guy. It just didn't work for us. High school friend Jackie Vitale said she and Kenny would set each other up with their classmates. She would play matchmaker for him, and he would make connections for her. I don't think he was very confident as a guy as much as he was in sports, she said. After one of Kenny's relationships ended, he wanted to start dating Nancy Smith, a shy cheerleader at Lee with kind eyes. Nancy lived in Morgan Hill, a well-to-do city on the opposite side of Lehigh. Friends worried that the studious, reserved Nancy and quiet Kenny would have little to say. Nancy's friends wondered what she was doing with Kenny, who had a reputation for not taking much in life seriously. Having Glenn as a brother helped build that reputation. But Kenny wasn't like the other boys, and Kenny and Nancy officially started dating, becoming their class's it couple. Nancy was a rock. She was responsible. She was trustworthy. She was so sweet, the kind of girl you'd want to start a family with someday. She kind of kept him settled down and gave him stability and confidence, and kind of kept him, I think, from getting into even more mischief, said Kenny's close friend Chris Camille. Sometimes when Kenny was going to Nancy's house, he'd urge his friends to come over in an hour to bail him out. Come over to the house, tell me you've got uneven teams and you need me to come and play, he'd tell friends like Dave Moretti. So Moretti would go over to Nancy's house and knock on the door, and he would recite his rehearsed lines. Nance, they need a guy, Kenny would tell Nancy. And Nancy would see through the caper and roll her eyes, but he was off to play anyway. He loved Nancy, but he loved playing basketball, Moretti said. By sophomore year, Kenny was still pretty small, but his athletic talent couldn't be ignored. He wound up making the varsity football team in 10th grade, one of only a handful of sophomores to do so, which allowed him to play alongside Glenn. He'd also make varsity as a sophomore in basketball and baseball, an uncommon feat at a school with nearly 2,000 students. At Lee, sophomores typically played for the fresh sophomore JV teams before playing varsity for 11th grade, but Kenny wasn't a typical athlete. You went from one sport to the next. We'd butt heads and knock each other silly on the football field, get up and shake hands, and see each other 6 weeks later on the basketball court and do the same, and then meet each other from the pitcher's mound and the batting box 8 weeks later, said Jeff Melrose of Campbell High, one of the West Valley Athletic League's top all-around athletes at the same time Kenny played. While Kenny spent a sophomore year of high school squarely in his brother's shadow, it was Glenn's senior year after all, Kenny started to establish himself, especially during baseball season, when Glenn quit the team. There was no one particular reason, and Kenny ended up starring as Lee's starting shortstop. His first game on varsity, he went 5-for-5. Yeah, he was in the right place, Lee baseball teammate Jim Evans said. Teammates, while impressed by Kenny's talents, soon learned to avoid warming up with him. I remember warming up with him before games or practice. If you were the one unlucky enough to be warming up with him, you knew you'd have a sore hand afterward, Evans said. Hal Kolstad, Kenny's high school baseball coach, had one of those major league careers that might have been completely forgotten if not for the Topps bubblegum cards. The flame-haired Wisconsin native pitched for the Boston Red Sox in 1962 and 1963, compiling an 0-4 win-loss record and an ERA somewhere past Saturn. After his playing days had exhausted themselves, Kolstad turned to teaching and coaching. He's remembered fondly by his former players for wearing those teeny-tiny pony-style shorts that were oddly popular with coaches in the 1970s, as well as the tobacco that was invariably wadded in his mouth. Sometimes, if Kolstad was perturbed during practice, he might call a player over and spit his chew into their glove, or take the wad of Red Man from his lip and put it in the player's hand. I can remember being in his PE class, and he used to send me to 7-Eleven to buy him some Red Man. I think he gave me a dollar, and I went and got him two packs of Red Man every once in a while, said former Lee baseball player Mike Thorpe. But Coach Kolstad was great. He had a good personality. He could be hard when he needed to, and he liked to have fun with us, and he was fun to play for. In Kenny, Kolstad found a polite, well-mannered kid and a natural talent. He came in playing very well. He just did everything naturally, and there wasn't really a lot of coaching that I had to do except work on his footwork as an infielder, Kolstad said. He had the coordination and the sense about what was going on around him all the time. Even though other players would never pick that up, he knew his presence early on. Kenny was out of Glenn's shadow for the first time, and it was comfortable for him. Baseball was breezy and carefree for Kenny for the final time in his life. There were no expectations, just fun, the thrill of competition, something to do before football season started again. And boy, did Kenny love to compete. He batted .423 in 16 league games his sophomore year, 22 hits in 52 at-bats, 11 runs, one triple, and one home run. He also compiled 30 putouts and 21 assists as the team's starting shortstop, along with 9 errors. The Longhorns went 10-6, and Kenny earned a selection to the All-League first team. Branham pitcher Roger Samuels, a lanky lefty, won MVP honors with an 8-0 record and a 1.40 ERA, while Lee outfielder Kevin Kevorkian and pitcher Dave Resch, with a 4-1 record, were also named to the All-League team. Drugs and alcohol flowed freely in San Jose and the Cambrian Park neighborhood and Lee High. It was ingrained in the region's DNA. Kenny had been drinking since his middle school days, despite California's legal drinking age being 21 since the 1930s. It wasn't strongly enforced. And by high school, he'd occasionally smoked weed, too. Cocaine and anabolic steroids were floating among his circle of friends. Kenny wasn't partaking in those things himself back then. That would come later. But for Kenny and his friends, there wasn't a big stigma around drugs. People close to him used. It was all no big deal. At most schools, athletes wouldn't touch drugs. At Lee, some athletes would get high before games. The culture of drugs in California was different. In the Midwest, you could tell the people who did drugs in high school and who didn't. athletes never did drugs, said Dino Sontag, who transferred to Lehigh and was 3 years behind Kenny. Moving to California, you play high school football. Those guys would get high before games. I couldn't understand that, and no one made a big deal about that. Beyond street drugs, Lee football players were known to use DMSO, or dimethyl sulfoxide, a solvent that was normally meant for horses. But when applied to the skin, it can speed up recovery time and serve as a pain reliever. It also left a garlic aftertaste in your mouth. A series of factors contributed to Lee's drug culture. The teens generally had latitude from their parents to do as they wished, and for many of them, what they wished to do was to drink and smoke dope. At the time Kenny was in high school, San Francisco ranked fourth in the country, behind Miami, Los Angeles, and New York, in the cocaine trade, a port of entry for drugs. Some of those drugs stayed local, and the middle to upper middle class student body had money to spend. They'd do things they weren't supposed to be doing, but what the hell? It was fun while they were doing it. Beyond substances, the campus culture could be cliquey, a series of overlapping circles. Jocks and nerds, bookworms and burnouts, skiers and surfers, and drinkers and dreamers. While it was easy for Kenny to insulate himself among the athletes, he floated among numerous groups, someone who was warm to classmates regardless of their popularity or the company they kept. The football players and the cheerleaders, they had these little circles, these little cliques, but he would talk to everybody, classmate Harriet Armstead said of Kenny, who was quick with a smile and a wave. We were African American, and in that school there were six of us. There were a lot of kids that didn't speak to you. Kenny could have skated by on his athletic talent or his looks, with his inviting blue eyes or a smile that made you feel warm inside. But he had a depth to him, a preternatural talent at making people feel more comfortable about themselves. He looked out for those who were liable to get picked on, like unpopular kids and those with disabilities. He'd stand up for someone, walk them between classes or to and from school, and you knew not to pick on them because Kenny had their back. He was the cool dude on campus. He was the kind of guy who everyone gravitated toward. He was always the guy I wish that I could be like, said Tim Halverson, who played sports with Kenny. He was like a magnet for the girls, and the other guys just wanted to hang out and be around him and talk to him and be a part of his life. He was such a good athlete and had that coolness factor. Plus, he was a good-looking guy. Everyone wanted to be around him. Mike Druin was the life of the party, someone who was always ready to respond with a witty reply or a punch. He and Kenny became fast friends through football and weightlifting and parties. Druin was nicknamed Egghead. He had kind of an egg-shaped head, said his brother Vic. In Druin, Kenny found someone who could match his zest for life, his recklessness. Druin was more vocal and animated. Kenny was more subdued, at least until he got a few beers in him and he loosened up. My brother was known for being a big partier around town, so Ken's parents hated my brother. They thought he was bringing Kenny down. But the fact of the matter was, my brother and Kenny were like Siamese party twins, Vic Druin said. In time, Mike Druin began selling coke, and drug use became more and more common for Kenny's circle of friends. Anyone who was friends with Mike, for the most part, snorted coke, said their classmate and friend Dan Lillis, who ended up rooming with Druin for about a year in the early 1980s. The thrill-seeking didn't all revolve around drugs and alcohol. Kenny became a meticulous diver in his family's backyard pool, jumping off the diving board again and again before graduating to the roof of their two-story split level. Pretty soon, he was diving off a rock overlooking a nearby reservoir that he and fellow teens knew simply as the Rock. It was 40 feet up, high enough to give most kids, but not this one, pause. All of a sudden, I see this guy just walk right to the edge and do a gainer, a backward flip, and I said, holy shit, who was that? Longtime friend Will Vince recalled of the moment he met Kenny. Diving aided Kenny's body control and helped teach him how to maneuver his body through space. He was graceful and precise in his dives, a counterbalance to the battering ram effort on the football field that left him with numerous injuries, including a jammed neck his senior year. Ken tried to keep quiet about the bumps and bruises, doing whatever he could to stay on the field. He'd grit it out or use a splint and tape. Glenn would help him conceal his injuries, too. His shoulder problems started from playing football. High school teammate and friend Vito Kengemi said of the injury that would linger during Caminiti's professional baseball career. It was a football injury that he had his junior and senior year. The injuries carried from football to basketball, where coach Ron Dietz could tell Kenny wasn't able to play at 100%. His senior year wasn't quite as good because he had damaged a thumb or maybe both thumbs in football, which of course he wouldn't tell you about or say anything about, Dietz said. If Kenny's first true love was sports and his second was Nancy, cars were his third love, a passion passed down from his father. When Kenny started driving, he ended up with a 1973 Chevy stepside pickup, driving fast and wild, laughing all the way. Other times he'd be driving a little more carefully, when Nancy was with him. And then he'd drop Nancy off at the end of the date, but instead of going straight home, he'd meet up with his friends, catching up with whatever he'd missed. In spite of, or maybe because of, Kenny's incorrigible side, Nancy became more involved in curating his circle of friends, pushing out those she didn't like or trust, from his female friends to people she thought were bringing out his wild side. Kenny didn't always listen, but he often did. He wanted to keep Nancy happy. Kenny was Lee's best baseball player, and by his senior year, everyone knew it. Opposing pitchers focused on him, either trying to bring their best stuff or pitching around him. They knew better than to groove one down the middle of the strike zone. And since Kenny wasn't selective, it meant he was swinging at tougher stuff as he developed from a contact hitter to a power hitter. While his batting average dropped season to season from .423 to .370 to .344, he was learning to drive the ball. In 1980, his junior year, he collected 3 doubles and 6 triples. His senior year, in 1981, he had 3 doubles, 3 triples, and 2 home runs. Kenny ended up being named All-League First Team in each of his 3 varsity seasons, but each time he missed out on the league MVP award. His senior year, to Dave Collishaw of League Champ Los Gatos, who went 5-3 with a 1.16 ERA as a pitcher and also batted above .450. Since I pitched, it was a dual merit, so they honored me with MVP over Ken, which is surprising, because he was a hell of an athlete, as we all know, Collishaw said. With each hit and each great play in the field, Kenny felt a deeper obligation to his teammates, his coaches, and his father most of all, a well-intentioned man who was seldom satisfied. Lee was quick to point out the mistakes and missed opportunities. Still, he looked out for his boy, and Kenny would do anything to make his father proud. His dad was really intense, one of those parents who pushed the kids and pushed him pretty hard to be as good as he could be, Tim Halverson said. The tough love was encouraged by Yvonne, who noticed qualities in Kenny that she previously recognized in her brother Eugene, who struggled with alcoholism. She urged Lee to be hard on Kenny. Maybe it would keep him on the right path. Given Kenny's football injuries, playing his favorite sport in college wasn't in the cards. There was always baseball, but where would he continue his career? The issue wasn't talent. he didn't have the grades for four-year schools like Stanford University or Santa Clara University or Cal Poly or the University of Hawaii or San Jose State. Solid universities with established baseball programs that would have been interested if his grades were better. I liked his hands. I thought he was a good player, and I liked the way he swung the bat, his approach and stuff. But academically, he was not one of the top students in the area, said Jerry McLean, then the baseball coach at Santa Clara University. That left junior college. California's two-year junior colleges were divided into geographic districts, and Ken's district covered West Valley College and Mission College. Sam Peraro, then the head coach at Mission College, wanted Kenny to play for him. "I was on Ken pretty heavy," Peraro said. "I can remember him sitting in my office, talking to him. He was pretty quiet, reserved, didn't say much." At that point in time, he was kind of a skinny kid. He had not filled out at all. But the one thing that I remember about Ken when I went out to see him play was his arm strength. He had the arm strength at an early age, and it was a nice throwing action. It was a powerful release out of his hand, and so you could tell he had a chance. He probably was going to be pretty good. Junior colleges were forbidden from directly contacting student-athletes located outside their district. But nothing was stopping players from reaching out to coaches themselves, and the JUCO coaches could try to connect with players through their high school coaches. So Hal Kolstad slipped his star shortstop a piece of paper with a phone number on it and told Kenny to call. Kenny dialed the number, and a man named John Oldham answered, and Kenny's future started coming into focus. Chapter 4. College Try. Despite his talent, Ken still had a lot to learn about baseball. Lucky for him, John Oldham, the head coach at San Jose City College, was a stickler for fundamentals. A lifetime earlier, Oldham was a player himself, a pretty damn good pitcher, good enough to get called up in 1956 by what was then called the Cincinnati Redlegs. He entered one game for Cincinnati as a pinch runner and never made another major league appearance. Decades after his day in the sun, Oldham ran a baseball factory at City College. Practices were split into blocks and scheduled minute by minute. A practice might consist of 15 or 16 workstations, with each station devoted to an aspect of hitting or fielding or base running. John Oldham was such a fundamentalist. He made us better ball players. There's no doubt about it. He threw our gloves away for a day and made us take infield barehanded and played with paddles and, you know, shit, we've never done that before, said Max Greg Sosby, who played against Ken in high school and as a college teammate quickly befriended him. In order to play the right way, Oldham thought, you needed to practice the right way. His program was an academy, and some of his former pupils included big leaguers like Dave Righetti and Dave Steve. Ken's course load included learning a new position. No more shortstop for Ken. Oldham shifted him to third base, where he'd have to face screaming line drives and bunts down the line and pop-ups into foul territory and slow choppers. I didn't think he had enough lateral movement to be a shortstop, Oldham said, so I moved him to third base, and he was probably the best third baseman that I ever had. His first step was so quick. He had really good hands and a strong arm. He was just a prototypical third baseman. The angles at third base were different. Shortstops had to cover lots of ground, and Ken, while a smart base runner, wasn't especially fleet of foot. At third, the ball was on top of you. Ken had good impulses and first steps. He was fearless. At third, he could unleash the weapon that was his arm. Call it a rifle, laser, cannon, rocket, bazooka. No matter what, it was deadly to base runners trying to reach first base, with an optimum distance of about 130 feet. For the first time, Ken's life revolved around baseball. He worked out in the morning, practiced, went to classes, played games, and partied with his teammates. there was no shift to another sport. No more football, his actual favorite sport to play, but one that his body couldn't withstand. No more basketball, his winter reprieve. At City College, baseball came with a year-round commitment. He devoted himself to weightlifting, too, something that helped to build his strength. He went from gangly and thin to muscle-bound and stockier. Oldham's program helped to reinforce Ken's work ethic. It showed him the effort required to be great. But despite so many adjustments for Ken, Oldham wasn't ready to allow one more change. For Ken to switch hitting games, something he'd been toying with and something that his father wanted. While many players who switch hit learn the skill as a youngster, when muscle memory is still being forged, Ken was picking up switch hitting in college. Lee Caminiti thought his son would be a fast study hitting lefty. Switch hitting could help Ken get extra attention from major league scouts, Lee believed. Of course, in Ken's case, switch hitting meant even more commitment, more batting practice, more frustration, more struggle. It was a specialized skill. Only a few dozen major league players switch hit at any given time, mainly because of how difficult it is. It's tough enough becoming proficient at hitting from your natural side of the plate. Now switch sides, hold the bat differently, use new muscles, the opposite side of your brain. A swing is like a fingerprint, unique for each hitter, and switch hitters effectively develop a second fingerprint. Despite Lee's intentions and Ken's practicing hitting left-handed out of season, Oldham said no to Ken switch hitting in games, which put Ken in a difficult spot, since his dad, the person he most wanted to impress, had problems with his coach, the person he most needed to impress. I think it was a tough time for Kenny because he believed in John and he needed discipline. He really felt like he was learning, said Joe Cucciara, a college teammate of Ken's. If he didn't do something right at practice, his dad would come to most practices and most games, and his dad would literally stand right behind the backstop watching everything, and I think that put a lot of pressure on Ken. That rift, the competing aims of his coach and his father, fueled Ken's internal pressure. He was a rubber play toy being pulled in two different directions. Every at-bat was a do-or-die moment for him, liable to disappoint one or both of these forces. And if he didn't perform, he'd carry that into the field with him, making him more likely to boot a ball at his new position. The expectations and frustrations wore on Ken. He wanted to quit, to walk away, to leave baseball behind. His love of baseball was gone. The feeling had been brewing in him since the end of his high school days, and during his freshman year of college, Ken had it with baseball. It wasn't even his favorite sport, but now his entire life revolved around baseball. And he was good, really good at baseball. Ken knew how gifted he was. He struggled with his burden. He worked as hard as anyone, but his talent surprised even him sometimes. Even with his heart not fully in it, he was still better than other guys. Lee knew how talented his son was, too, which is why he wouldn't let Ken quit. "I think you should give it one more year," Lee told Ken. Ken didn't want to let his father down, and he didn't want to throw his gift away. The shame would have been overwhelming. Shame wasn't something he needed more of, especially the shame of potentially walking away from his destiny. And if he quit, he could look at Glenn's life to see a potential view into his baseball-less future. Glenn was working as a carpenter and had hurt his back in a motorcycle wreck. It wasn't a glamorous path. Ken would keep playing, not out of love of the game, but out of a sense of obligation. Through baseball, people saw value in him, even if he didn't always see it in himself. Being a part of the team gave him a connection. He did always love the team aspect of sports. His teammates loved his dedication, his commitment to his craft. They loved his commitment to everything. And baseball was a venue for him to compete and to challenge himself. Life's all about competition. We compete for girls. We compete for jobs. We compete for a spot on the team, whatever. Everything's competition, Ken told his friend and teammate Mark Triplett during their year together playing for the City College Jaguars. He loved competition. He got it. He got it young. He was only 19. I was 21, thinking, wow, that's kind of deep. It stuck with me, Triplett said. He competed. And there's no end to his competing. He had that fire inside. Triplett was a high-octane center fielder who might have been the only player with a dirtier uniform than Ken's, thus the nickname Pigpen, like the character from the Peanuts comic strip who was surrounded by a cloud of dust. From the outfield, Triplett watched Ken make play after play at third, and he felt a connection. This guy was playing the game the way he played it, too. He was like a Labrador retriever going for a ball. The way he charged bunts was nuts, and that's where he developed diving behind third base, popping up, sticking his chest out, waiting for a second, and then just letting it go. He had a laser. He's the one guy who fired me up more than anybody else I played with, Triplett said. But, being the older guy, Triplett used to ride Ken, too. It was mostly playful, tongue-in-cheek, but every now and again, he'd push Ken's buttons a little bit. He's playing third. The batter hits a bullet, and the ball takes a bad hop, hits him in the cheek, rolls into foul ground. He stands up, kind of rubs his cheek, and walks over and picks up the ball, Triplett said. After the inning was over, Triplett confronted Ken in the dugout. What the fuck was that? Triplett asked. What are you talking about? Ken said. George Brett picks up the ball, throws him out, then decides if he's got a face or not. Triplett quickly laughed off the conversation and forgot about it. Not Ken. I swear to God, 2 or 3 weeks later, the same thing happens. Roller takes a bad hop, he takes it off his face, picks up the ball, throws him out, and I'm like, holy shit! When I got into the dugout, he comes up and goes, hey, how'd George Brett like that? Triplett said. Older players like Mark Webb and Joe Cucciara would look out for Ken, serving as mentors and helping him to harness his talents. The best player on the team, more polished and refined than Ken, was pitcher Randy Kramer. The Aptos High product was the best JUCO pitcher in the region, and maybe the state that year. In 1982, San Jose City College was going to go as far as Kramer would take them. He was the most complete pitcher I've ever seen at that level. He had all the pitches. He had all the pickoff moves. He could feel his position like a cat. He had it all, Triplett said of Kramer. He was lights out. He was throwing 90 with stuff, and he was composed. At that level, he was amazing. Smooth. The only thing we'd make fun of is he was perfectly dressed. He was well-groomed, pearl drops, a stellar smile. Ken settled in at third base, providing steady defense and pop at the plate as City College jumped out in front of the Golden Gate Conference standings. Despite Ken's emergence, his partying became a concern for Oldham. He started hearing whispers that Ken likes to drink. Sometimes there were hints about drugs. Ken wasn't even 20, and lots of kids his age were doing the same things. Whenever they had an overnight road trip, the players would wait until after curfew and sneak out. One time, Oldham overheard some of the players talking about their plans, so he asked Triplett to have a team meeting to send a message. No partying tonight, Triplett warned his teammates. As the meeting ended and the players prepared to disperse, the conversation changed with coaches out of earshot. So, where are we going? As the Jaguars gelled, players noticed something odd. Wallets and money disappeared from their lockers during practice. They dubbed the unknown thief the dugout bandit. The situation fueled distrust and resentment. Who was doing this? Why? Players got creative to avoid getting their pockets picked. Guys on the team were on the field with their wallet in their uniform pocket. Instead of a can of Skol, they had their wallet, said infielder Billy Smith. The situation got pushed aside as the wins piled up. Behind Kramer's pitching and a solid lineup, the Jaguars spent most of the season ahead of rival Laney College out of Oakland, the conference champs from the previous season. City College wrapped up the regular season with a 20-7 record. Laney finished second, one game back. The second through fifth place teams entered a playoff. Whichever team won the playoff would face San Jose City for the chance to advance to the state playoffs, which attracted lots of major league scouts. A chance for Ken to showcase his talents. But City College needed to qualify first, against Laney, which advanced out of the bracket with a dramatic extra inning comeback win. All San Jose needed to do was win one game of its doubleheader against Laney to advance, and the team had the league's hottest pitcher. But days before the doubleheader, the dugout bandits struck again. The coaches did some investigative work, and finally, after a season of everyone's items disappearing from the locker room, the coach's suspicion fell on a surprising figure, Randy Kramer. Oldham, believing the dugout bandit to be Kramer, made the tough decision to boot the ace with all the pitches and all the pickoff moves and the perfect outfits and stellar smile, three players on the team said. Kramer would go on to pitch in the majors and live an upstanding life, but he wouldn't be pitching in the playoffs for City College, which was welcome news to Laney. It was real crazy. We didn't find out until we got there, Laney pitcher Joe Odom said of Kramer's dismissal. The moms made cupcakes with everybody's number on it. They ended up giving us all the cupcakes. They just knew they were going to win one out of two. City College could have used Kramer against Laney. Odom's arm was rubber. He went deep in the first game, a Laney win, and after San Jose went up in the second game, Odom came back out and threw some more, and Laney came back to win. Laney advanced to states. City College was eliminated. No state playoffs. No scouts. It would have been neat for Ken to play for his hometown team, the San Francisco Giants. In the early 1980s, the team hosted open tryouts at Candlestick Park. Players were recommended by coaches or learned about the tryout through word of mouth. Ken attended the tryout with Max Greg Sosby, his friend and City College teammate. Ken made the final 50 players, but that's as far as he got. Thanks, no thanks. Ken would play at Candlestick Park again, someday. Chad Roseboom picked up his life and moved from Illinois to California to take a graduate assistant position at San Jose State University. But since grad assistants don't make much money, he lined up a delivery job at a Budweiser distributorship, and one of his supervisors needed someone to coach a summer ball team, and Roseboom said, why not? And that's how he was introduced to Ken Caminiti. He had the most unbelievable arm you've ever seen for a kid that age, Roseboom said. Ken also had a pretty swing from both sides of the plate, and he was tough as hell. Even after badly spraining his ankle and barely able to walk, Ken continued showing up to play. The grad assistant called his new boss, Gene Mangus, a barnacle of a man who washed up at San Jose State as a quarterback in 1948, and spent the next four decades there coaching football or baseball. One of the players he coached on the gridiron was Dick Vermeil, the Super Bowl champion NFL head coach. Hey, you gotta come look at this guy, Roseboom told Mangus. They weren't necessarily planning to steal away Ken from City College, but Mangus came out and watched this Caminiti guy and talked to him and assured him that they didn't have any problems with him switch hitting. Hell, they'd let him take double the batting practice. And pretty soon, Ken was transferring to San Jose State. Which was news to Oldham, who expected to work with Ken another year and help him develop into a pro prospect. While Ken's aggravations at City College, aided by his father's switch hit demands, along with a spat over sliding headfirst due to his bad shoulders, were well known to his friends, Oldham didn't recognize the fractures and frustrations that had been brewing inside Ken. I had heard that he was leaving, and I spent the summer trying to chase him down to find out what was going on, Oldham said. I finally caught up with him one day, and he said he was leaving. Ken's parents, concerned by his increased partying, hoped a change of scenery would be good for him. The transfer meant that Ken would have to wait until his junior year before turning pro. The eligibility for four-year colleges and universities was different from that for junior and community colleges, from which you can be drafted at any time. If Ken had stayed at City College, he could have entered the 1983 draft. Transferring to San Jose State meant he'd wait until 1984. Nabbing Ken was a nice coup for state baseball, which went 14-39 the season before Ken arrived, a forgotten program behind the money-generating forces of football and men's basketball. Donations to the Spartan Foundation by the father of a player, Marco Trapani, and other fans and parents freed up scholarship money that helped San Jose State recruit Ken. The campus was located in downtown San Jose, which by the 1980s was run down, with a row of dilapidated buildings lining its western edge. There was nothing, former San Jose State field hockey coach Carolyn Lewis said of the area surrounding the campus. It was pretty much a total commuter community. One coach at the time had a process for bringing recruits for campus visits. I pick them up in the dead of night, bring them to campus, have them here for the full campus visit, and then take them back at night to the airport so they couldn't see downtown San Jose. Some of those run-down buildings housed fraternities, and without pledging a frat, there wasn't much to do at the school. Ken ended up rushing Sigma Alpha Epsilon, a frat full of jocks, baseball, football, and basketball players. One frat brother, Bob Berland, became an Olympic medalist in judo. Another, Dan Clark, played Nitro on the sports competition TV show American Gladiators. One time, the SAE brothers had rushes, timid recruits who wished to join the frat, line up blindfolded at midnight at a softball park for an initiation event. The brothers had ordered a pile of ice shavings from a local ice company and dumped them on the ground. Ken and the other brothers started making balls out of snow and ice and throwing them at the recruits. Whoosh! Ken had fire in his eyes, and with his arm, oh boy, he was chucking them at some of the guys. Whoa, watch out, guys. This is going to be something else. I stayed clear. I knew this guy's got an arm, and it's going to hurt. It's not fun and games anymore, said Kevin Sullivan, a baseball teammate and friend of Ken's. Rick Schroeder spent years cultivating a relationship with Ken and his family. Schroeder drifted from coaching to scouting after an unspectacular playing career. His area was Northern California, and Rick adored Ken's game. His instincts, his arm strength, his gap power, Ken had it. The Texas Ranger scout was first tipped off about Ken by a scout and coach named Red Walsh, an old Milwaukee Braves farmhand. You may have heard of his granddaughter, Carrie Walsh Jennings, the beach volleyball legend. The Rangers had a team in the Peninsula Winter League, known affectionately as Scouts League. Scouts assembled teams of top Bay Area college players and low-level minor leaguers. The league gave players a chance to mature and scouts a snow globe view of prospective draft picks playing against talented competition. He'd come by my place, and most of the time he'd come with me to the games, Schroeder said of Ken. Kenny surfaced in that league, and that's where he became a player. Schroeder became close with Ken and his family. What wasn't there to like? Ken was great, and so was his family. This was a deep bond between Schroeder and the Caminitis, something that went beyond a scout simply trying to steer a prospect in his direction. For years, Schroeder would eat Thanksgiving dinner with the Caminitis. Rick Schroeder was family, and he had the inside track on getting Ken drafted. It took Dana Corey watching Ken for one play, in one practice, before he knew he'd have to find a new position. Corey was the big dog on San Jose State's team, a senior entering the 1983 season. He started at third base the season before. During the first practice of Corey's senior year, the infielders were taking ground balls, and Corey fielded the ball and threw to first. Right on the money. His backup, Jeff Crace, was next. And then the skinny transfer kid was up. The coach hit a ball down the line, and he made a backhanded play on the chalk and threw an absolute howitzer across the diamond, Corey said. I went up to the coach after practice and told them I could play second base, too. Ken announced his presence to the rest of his new teammates and competitors during a doubleheader on February 14, 1983, at Stanford, a College World Series finalist the year before. The games were initially scheduled for that Saturday, but rain turned sunken diamond to soup, necessitating a two-day delay. In the first game, a 9-2 Stanford win, Ken hit a homer from the left side against pitcher Brian Myers, then turned around in the second game, a 15-11 defeat, and slugged another from the right. After the second home run, Corey went up to Ken in the dugout. "What'd you get?" Corey asked Ken. "What do you mean? What was the pitch?" "I don't know." Corey was trying to scrape and grind for any advantage he could get, and here was Ken making it all seem so simple. See the ball, hit the ball. Despite the simplistic approach to hitting, Ken became more of a student of the game during his time at San Jose State. If there was a rainout and no practice, Ken would go to the batting cages for 4 hours and hit from both sides of the plate, just working on little things, teammate Rudy Escalante said. It was amazing. He also practiced switch hitting on his own, having his friend Will Vince throw him BP so he could get more comfortable hitting lefty. As a switch hitter, Ken was forced to see the ball differently. From the dugout when his team was at bat, Ken began focusing on the ball coming out of the pitcher's hand, studying release points and trying to give himself an edge when he was in the batter's box. Teammates noticed Ken separating from the pack during his sophomore season. His intensity and defensive prowess became otherworldly. Mark Webb, who played with Ken at City College and San Jose State, recalled a play Ken made against UC Berkeley on a liner on the backside of the line. Ken dove and snared the ball in his glove. He gets up, and he's still kind of falling away, and he throws a rocket across the diamond that I swear to God just barely cleared the top of the mound that was rising as it got to the first baseman. And that's the first time that I was kind of in awe of something he did, and not only the agility, but the power of his arm. That's when I just said, "Holy shit," Webb said. That's the first time I saw that boy become a man. We're kind of in a sunken level in the diamond, so you can see the throw. I don't think it ever got 24 inches off the ground, but it was right by the time it got to first base. You know, that's a long throw. He was off balance, and he just threw a lace across the diamond to make a play. And it was one of those things where everybody starts laughing. You can't believe he did it, right? In a game against Fresno State, John McLarnon was on the mound, and the catcher called for an outside pitch, and the ball was lined to third base, about 3 feet in front of Ken. The ball bounced up, hit off his forehead, and went right by me on the pitcher's mound, McLarnon said. Ken walked up. You could see this knot growing off his forehead, with the emblem of the ball and the threads in his eyes rotating. The coach, everybody, ran out to see what was going on, and he refused to come out of the game. His toughness was never, never questioned. San Jose State opened its league schedule on March 25th and 26th with doubleheaders, and they swept all four games. This from a team that had won 8 league games the prior season. But the Spartans quickly settled back to earth, losing 5-state against Fresno State, including a string of 19 innings without a run. San Jose State hung in behind steady pitching by McLarnon and Ed Bass, the speedy play of shortstop Ed Krause, and timely hitting from Ken, Corey, and Dwayne Graybill. After a 3-game sweep at San Francisco, San Jose State entered an April 20th doubleheader, only 2.5 games behind St. Mary's College of California in the NCBA standings. The Spartans saw the postseason within reach, but the Gales won the opener 8-0, then squeaked past in the nightcap 8-7, sending San Jose State to 8-8 in league play and all but ending the team's hopes of making the playoffs. Ken found a way to contribute wherever he was playing. In a 5-3 win against Santa Clara on May 11th, he made a key play in left field to stop a rally. With a runner on third, Jeff Nolet hit a sinking liner to left field. Left fielder Ken Caminiti sprinted in and slid to one knee to snare the ball just above the turf, saving a run and ending the inning, the Spartan Daily reported. Ken also led off the fifth inning with a single and scored on a double by Dana Corey, then hit a sacrifice fly an inning later to drive in another run. Against Santa Clara on May 15th, Ken went 5-for-7, slugging a key home run in the first game of the doubleheader, then adding two doubles in Game 2. He finished his sophomore season with a .299 batting average, 7 home runs, and a team-leading 36 RBIs. He was on his way. Being so close to home meant the party continued with Ken's high school friends. One time, when they were 19 or 20 years old, Ken spent the night drinking with John Belmont and Mike Druhan. Belmont had a fake ID, so they went to get beer at a 7-Eleven across from Los Gatos High School. No shoulder tapping necessary. Dozens of people were congregating outside. "Kenny, stay in the truck," Belmont told him. "Don't hurt nobody." Kenny didn't usually look for fights. Sometimes they found him. Belmont and Druhan went to buy beer. "We came out, and Kenny was beating the heck out of this guy," Belmont said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.